Jehoshaphat, his name means Yahweh Shofet, our Lord will judge, has one key problem, and you should already know about it, because he has already been an ally, and we looked at this passage already once before. Remember that he was asked by the northern king to be a part of a war. Do you remember Jehoshaphat's contribution to this? Does anybody remember this story? He was asked to be part of a war when the king of the north came to him and said, "Will you join us?" And he answered, "My troops are your troops. We're all family." And then as they get ready for war, what was it Jehoshaphat had told the king of the north? Okay, that the dressing thing happens afterwards. Now, here's the thing. It's not the dressing. This is, I mean, I get what you're saying, but it's before that. Okay, prophet didn't say nice things about the king of the north. It all came about because Jehoshaphat said, "Well, I'll be happy to put my stuff at your disposal. Here's what I need you to do. You got a prophet that like has told us from the Lord what to do? Jehoshaphat, here's his tagline. Know how to make friends." Because Jehoshaphat gets in bed with the wrong people. And in fact, it frames his life. He is called a good king. And some good things happen. Now, where do you put this? Well, 1 Kings 15:24, he becomes king. Okay? But it's not until chapter 22 that he actually is in a story. Let's just remind ourselves of the story very quickly. We don't have to do the story again because you did it already. But go to 1 Kings 22 and take a look at verse 1. 3 years passed without war between Aram and Israel. This is the northern kingdom. And in the third year, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, came down to the king of Israel. Now the king of Israel said to his servants, "Do you know that Ramoth Gilead belongs to us, and we are still doing nothing to take it out of the hand of the king of Aram?" And he said to Jehoshaphat, "Will you go with me to battle at Ramoth Gilead?" Jehoshaphat said to the king, "I am as you are, my people as your people, my horses as your horses." Moreover, Jehoshaphat said, "Please inquire first for the word of the Lord," and there it is. Now we studied this story before. And what you see is Jehoshaphat was perfectly willing to do right, but not as discerning about his friends. And that's probably the thing that frames his life. Next to 1 Kings 22, let's say, where does he show up? In verse 2? If he shows up first time in verse 20, in verse 2, I would write next to that 2 Chronicles 17 to 21. 2 Chronicles 17 to 21. Now, if you read 2 Chronicles 17 to 21, you'll get a better view of him. So I'd like you to stop there and jump over to Chronicles if you can, because we don't really get any new information about him in the 1 Kings narrative. We've got to go to 2 Chronicles, and I'd like to pick up 2 Chronicles. Let's just very quickly mention where he shows up in 17, and we'll dive into 18, because that's where it will be important. Okay, 2 Chronicles 17, okay? So we are running parallel to 1 Kings 22. So I would write next to 2 Chronicles 17, 1 Kings 22, 2 to 50. Jehoshaphat's son became king in his place. Jehoshaphat's going to rule 25 years. He's the son of Asa. What do you know about him as he comes into the office because he's the son of Asa? We know that the kingdom of Judah, when Jehoshaphat is growing up, was under a king who ridded the kingdom of a lot of the bad stuff and followed God. And the earlier Jehoshaphat was born in his reign, the more he would have seen Asa walking with God. The later, he wouldn't have seen a bad man. He would have been a moral man, but not as on fire and hot for God. Okay? So give that as a background for Jehoshaphat. You might make a note somewhere and just say, you know, Asa, his dad was Asa, and his dad followed God early, but he was more put on a show a little bit later. And so It's going to matter because it's going to, this is the kid who grows up in the Christian home with the parents who used to be vibrantly in love with Jesus, who now don't do any bad stuff, but don't really have a hot heart for God. Does that make sense? Okay. So when you get to verse 2, he placed troops in all the fortified cities of Judah, set garrisons in the land of Judah and in the cities of Ephraim, which Asa, his father, had captured. So what we know about him in 2 Chronicles 17 is that the first thing he does is he builds on his father's successes by securing them in verse 2. He goes out there and he secures the people and the physical assets that his father handed him. Now we get to his spiritual life. The Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he followed the example of his father David, of his father David's earlier days, and did not seek Baals. So he seems to have a tender heart toward God. Asa, his father, did, so did he, but sought the God of his father, followed his commandments, and did not act as Israel did. So he didn't follow after the gods of Israel, the calves. He didn't go after Hathor. He didn't go after any of the other foreign gods, but he followed the God of his father David, the heart of Yahweh. So the Lord established the kingdom in his control, and all Judah brought tribute to Jehoshaphat and had great riches, and he had great riches and he had honor. He took great pride in the ways of the Lord and again removed high places from the Asherim from Judah. So some things that had cropped up again as his father got older, he erased. Jehoshaphat has an advantage. He came into a kingdom that was pretty good, so he didn't have the darkness that he could have had. But there's a constant pull of darkness back into the people, and he has to correct it. Verse 7. In the third year of his reign, he sent his officials, Ben-Hael, Obadiah, Zechariah, Nathaniel, Micaiah, to teach in the cities of Judah, and with them Levites, and he names all those Levites, and he says, verse 9, they taught in Judah, having the book of the law and of the Lord with them, and they went throughout all the cities of Judah and taught among all the people. Why is that unique?
Instead of just removing the bad stuff, they were actually teaching the good stuff.
This is the first time you've seen this. We are all the way into the reign now, down at the fourth king of Judah, and this is the first time you've seen all the way back, really, from the time of Solomon, this is the first time you see God's word being publicly proclaimed in streets by people who are trained, not haphazardly, and the king, the civil authority, has planned to do this. So this is an important moment. And what was the following up of it? Verse 10. Now the dread of the Lord was on all the kingdoms of the lands which were around Judah, so that they would not make war against Jehoshaphat. We keep seeing the same thing. If you focus on your kingdom falls apart. If you focus on the Lord, your kingdom is built. War Room was a movie that said if you focus on your marriage, you will lose the fight. If you focus on the Lord, you'll gain your marriage. You're fighting the wrong battles. Stop trying to figure out a way to conquer the sin that keeps getting the best of you. Turn your attention toward trying to walk with God. Let Him be strong for you. He says He gives you a way of escape. He says that. Let Him show you where it is. So if you focus on the problem grows. If you focus on the Lord, the problem gets smaller. It's that simple, but it's that hard, right? Because the problem seems so much louder than God. Some of the Philistines brought gifts and silver as tribute to Jehoshaphat. The Arabians also brought him flocks, 7,700 rams, 7,700 male goats. So Jehoshaphat grew greater and greater. He built fortresses and store cities in Judah. He had large supplies in the cities of Judah. Warriors, valiant men, verse 14. This was their muster according to the father's households. And he goes on and he starts telling you from this verse through 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. He gets down to at the end of 18 telling you how many people, how many people, how many people, how many people. There's this great army that is built. And then it says, these are those, verse 19, who serve the king apart from those whom the king put in the fortified cities throughout all Judah. So all you have is 17 is nothing more than background on this guy. But the background you have is he's a good guy. What's his problem? Do we remember? What's his problem? He just gets in bed with the wrong people. He's a good guy. He loves God. Listen, many of you will find that the way that the enemy will come up against people you love dearly is they will commit their way to the Lord, and then they will find themselves surrounded by the wrong people. They'll make the wrong friend choices. If the enemy can't get you to sin, he'll surround you with people that pull you off step by step. If he can't knock you off your game in one punch, he's going to do it slowly, drip by drip. He's going to work on you. And the easiest way to do that is put somebody in your life that will pull you away. Now, 18 tells the story. Jehoshaphat had riches and honor. He allied himself by marriage with who? Are you kidding me? He aligned himself by marriage with Ahab. Here's a guy walking with God, and he marries Ahab's daughter. That would be the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. That would be the personification of bad family. Why? Because Jehoshaphat's a good guy. Maybe just a touch naive, but he gets in bed with the wrong people. Quite literally. Okay? Verse 2. Some years later, he went down to visit Ahab at Samaria. And Ahab slaughtered many sheep and oxen for him and the people who were with him and induced him to go against Ramoth Gilead. Ahab, king of Israel, said to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, will you go with me to Ramoth Gilead? Now you're seeing the story, but you're seeing a different pronunciation of the story. Why? There's a marriage there. It's different when you're talking family now. The reason he was being what he was being in the last story is, hey, your kids are like my kids, your flocks, my horses, your horses. We're all family. It's because he was. He had no business being family with Ahab and Jezebel. But he was. And that's why he says what he says in verse 3. But in verse 4, he seems aloof. What's aloof in verse 4? You tell me. What doesn't seem like he's getting it? Asking Ahab to inquire of the Lord is like asking Satan to inquire of God. Okay? How disconnected do you have to be from the local news to not know Ahab and Jezebel are not where you go looking for a prophet of the Lord? Then the king of Israel assembled prophets, 400 of them. Shall we go? Go up, for God will give it into your hand. But Jehoshaphat said, is there not yet a prophet of the Lord here that we may inquire of him? See, you got lots of prophets, you just don't have one of the right God. And he seems to be naive that, like, God's not, you know, Yahweh's not doing well in this kingdom. Well, you think? Here's the thing. He's married to a girl from the family. What are the chances he really doesn't understand the evil involved in this family? Jehoshaphat said, maybe we should get a prophet from the Lord. And the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, there's one guy, but I hate him because he never prophesies good concerning me. Remember the story? Now, the story takes on a different element when you start to see it from Jehoshaphat's perspective. But all I wanted you to walk away with is he joined Ahab against the will of God. He allied himself later on with Ahaziah again. Twice you see him in alliances, 2 Chronicles 18 and 2 Chronicles 20. He's constantly making the wrong choices, and I think it's because he married Ahab's daughter. I think he put close to him a person who didn't have God's heart. I think he grew up having God's heart and maybe was a naive Christian kid, if I can say that about an ancient Hebrew king. You know how I mean it. I think he warred against Aram and he called out to the Lord when Judah was invaded and he did right in the sight of the Lord. But I also think that he allied himself. You know, one of the last comments we have about him is in 2 Chronicles 20, verses 35 to 37, chapter 20, 2 Chronicles 20, he's allied himself with Israel to make ships. In other words, the story of this guy's life is he's got a good heart, good family, bad wife, bad friends. And he makes a left turn. It's not that everything he did was wrong. It's that significant relationships in his life were compromised. I want to pick up with the fifth king, the king Jehoram, but you've already become used to this guy's name because Joram or Jehoram is the same name. And there was one in the south that matches one in the north. And so we crossed paths with this when we were doing our southern stories. Let's take a look beginning in 2 Kings chapter 8, and that puts us squarely in the last part of the divided kingdom box there. 2 Kings chapter 8, we're still in the time period. He's about an 8-year king from 848 down to about 841 or 840. And we're still in the time period when there's a northern and a southern kingdom. And Jehoram, he's an interesting king in the respect that if there's something to hang on him, well, maybe the best place to do this is second half of chapter 8, 2 Kings 8 and chapter 9 is really his story. Now, the problem is there are two Jehorams or Joram. One is J-I and one is J-J, okay? So I'm going to call them by Jehoram Israel or Jehoram Judah, J-I or J-J, okay? That's just going to make life a little bit easier. So I want to pick up the story, and I want to go to 2 Kings, and I just want to get my Bible in that spot, 2 Kings chapter 8, and I'm near the end of the chapter. I'm looking at down around verse 25. Verse 24, 8:24 says, Joram slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. Ahaziah, his son, became king in his place. That it will be Joram, that will be Joram of Judah because he's buried in the city of David. In the 12th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, king of Israel, Ahaziah, the king of Jehoram, king of Judah, began to reign. So notice here in 24 and in 25, you have both Jehorams mentioned. And that's what I was trying to get you to see. Now, let's go to 8:16 and back up just a little bit, because there's a story in 8:16, and I'd like somebody to read 8:16 down to the verses we just read.
Now, in the 5th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, king of Israel, Jehoshaphat, being then the king of Judah, Joram, the son of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, became king. He was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. He walked in the way of the kings of Israel, just as the house of Ahab had done. For the daughter of Ahab became his wife, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord. However, the Lord was not willing to destroy Judah for the sake of David, his servant, since he had promised him to give the lamp to him through his sons always. In his days, Edom revolted from under the hand of Judah and remained king over themselves. Then Joram crossed over to Zer and all his chariots with him, and he arose by night and struck the Edomites who had surrounded him and the captains of the chariots, but his army fled to their tents. So Edom revolted against Judah to this day. Then Libnah revolted at the same time. The rest of the acts of Joram and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah?
Okay, now when you actually look at his reign, the problem with this is if you don't mark your Bible now, you'll never get this right later. So pick through it very carefully. Go to verse 16 again. In the 5th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, that makes him J.I. In the 5th year of J.I., son of Ahab, because Ahab would only be the king of the north, right? Jehoshaphat, being the king of Judah, Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat, became king of Judah, and that makes him J.J. So the second half is J.J. J.J. was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem, a dead giveaway that he's J.J. and not J.I., right? Because he's reigning from Jerusalem. And he walked in the ways of the kings of, wait a minute, walked in the way of the kings of Israel? but he's a king of Judah. He's trying to tell you he acted more like the bad kings of the north than the good kings Asa and Jehoshaphat, his grandpa and his dad. He departed from what his dad and his grandfather did and went to be more like the neighbors. Now, stop and ask yourself, how could that have happened? And once again, you will see an action of the three chairs. You'll see Asa, who will walk with God, Jehoshaphat, who will walk with God, but choose wrong friends and make critical compromises in his life. And by the time his son comes to the throne, the compromised father left him as a cynical son. So he went from a passionate heart to follow God to a part-time heart to follow God to a cynical heart not to follow God. And in three generations, we've talked about the three chairs before, you got the idea. Let's move through this. Verse 18 says, he walked like the kings of Israel, even though he's a king of Judah, because there's a leftover commitment God had to Judah. Now, here's what I want you to see. JJ had some of the wrong friends. I know that because if I go down to say 18 to 23, I can find that his first big mistake was he walked like an Israelite. Why? Why does it say in verse 18 he walked like an Israelite?
He was married to Ahab's daughter.
Because, like his father, he found himself literally in bed with the other team. He joined a doomed family because they looked like they were going places. They were doomed. Now, all he did was marry a girl. After all, that's only a natural desire. But think about it. Sin comes when we take a perfectly natural desire or a longing or an ambition that's perfectly reasonable and try desperately to fulfill it without God. The birth of sin in you is taking the normal desire of life and trying to fulfill it without God. It'll happen, you'll see it 1,000 times over in life. The desire to want to be married, if you're the person who God has called to be married, is a perfectly natural desire. Try to do it without God, it'll be the worst mistake you've ever made. Okay? Augustine, in his Confessions, was the one who said, not only is it sin, it is a perverse distortion of the image of the Creator in us. All good things and all our security are rightly found only and completely in Him. So try to fill your needs without Him, and you will find that distortion will come back and bite you. Sidney Harris wrote this. He said, once we assuage our conscience by calling something a necessary evil, it begins to look more and more necessary and less evil. And over time, we just get to that place. Now, he starts off with the wrong pals, but that's not all he does. Look at verse 19. Put with verse 19 something, I called it wrong assessments. This early in the story, we read the heart of the problem. What's the heart of the problem? JJ made a choice. He wanted Athaliah to be his queen. He wanted to mimic the world's worst family ever and mirror their apparent success. So he compounded his own problems, and he made a second mistake. He misread God's patience in the early success of his reign as though God's stamp of approval was on him. Let me say it this way. He starts off, he makes compromising moves, but God doesn't smack him down, so he assumes God's either not paying attention or God's okay with it. And that's a terrible idea. One of the nicest things God can do for you is not let you get away with wrong, but catch you in your wrong. Why? If you get away with your wrong, why is that a problem? You're going to keep growing in the size of the wrong you do because you think you're getting away with it. I was talking to a guy the other day who has now twice broken the law and twice gotten caught. And I tried to convince him he needs to go in another line of work because it isn't working out for him. And my point is, God has been so good to you. He said, good, I've been in jail. I said, yes, that is good. He said, no, it's not, it's terrible. I said, no, if you got away with it, you'd end up killing somebody. But the fact that every time you do anything wrong, you get caught is the mercy of God in your life. The problem we've had more often than not is we got away with something and that created a bigger problem. Now, I think one of the things that happened here is that he drew the wrong conclusions. He didn't notice the fragmentation that was allowing his that God was allowing in his kingdom, because he didn't really catch on to what God was doing. So I want you to notice, where is the fragmentation in verse 20? What's the first part that falls off his kingdom? JJ loses a section of land. What is it called? Okay, the Edomites revolted. And then after that, Libna revolted. And you can see that down in 22 and 23. And JJ dies at the end of this as a man with broken dreams. He doesn't end up with the story he thought he was going to have. Because he made bad choices, he ends up with broken dreams. But that isn't the end of the story. It never is. When he chose to intertwine his life with a condemned and despicable family, he placed a curse on his own children. Why? Do you remember what God said about Ahab? Ahab and Jezebel. You remember Elijah? Do you remember what he said? You're all going to die, every one of you. Every one of your children are going to die. And if you're out in the field, the birds will eat you. And if you're in the city, the dogs will eat you. You're going to die on the ground without honor. If you marry into that curse, then your children become part of it. JJ was interested in mimicking the world at the expense of God's prophecies and at the expense of what God had said would happen. So he put a curse on his own kids. History is changed by compromises and bad choices, and the choices we make take a lifetime to show themselves, and the victorious moves of God will either be tragedies or will be victories. It will all come down to this. If we walk away from God, we're going to face the end of that. But we can also bring other people into play. Too many words. If you choose to get married, and you choose to have children, and you choose not to walk with God, you're not only affecting yourself, you're also affecting your children. And they're going to live with the results of what you do. Now, God can still save them. He can turn that tragedy into something beautiful. But don't think for a moment that it's not partly your fault. It is. Mike Iaconelli wrote this. He said, I live in a small rural community. There are a lot of cattle ranches around here, and every once in a while, a cattle wanders off and gets lost. Ask a rancher how a cow gets lost, and chances are he'll reply, well, that cow starts nibbling on a tuft of green grass, and when it finishes, it looks ahead of the next tuft of green grass and starts nibbling on that one, and then it nibbles on another tuft right next to it, and then it gets to one that's near a hole in the fence, and then it keeps on eating, and then it sees another tuft of green grass, and now it's on the other side of the fence, so it nibbles on that one and goes all the way to the next tuft, and the next thing you know, the cow has nibbled himself into being lost. Americans are in the process, Mike writes, of nibbling their way to being lost. We keep moving from one tuft of activity to another, never noticing how far we've gone from home or how far away from the truth we've managed to end up. I think that's a really good analogy. It's worth remembering. Let me go to verses 24 to 29. Can somebody read 8, 24 to 29?
So Joram slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. And Ahaziah his son became king in his place. In the 12th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, king of Israel, Ahaziah the son of Jehoram, king of Judah, began to reign. Ahaziah was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned 1 year in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Athaliah, the granddaughter of Omri, king of Israel. He walked in the way of the house of Ahab and did evil in the sight of the Lord, like the house of Ahab had done, because he was son-in-law of the house of Ahab. Then he went with Joram, the son of Ahab, to war against Hazael, king of Aram, at Ramoth-Gilead, and the Arameans with Joram.
No, that's okay. That's far enough. Go back to 24 for a minute and read it this way. Enter the 22-year-old Ahaziah, Ahaziah. He's the son of JJ the Entangler, but he's also nephew of J.I. the Condemned. He's a family, he's living under the condemnation of God because the two families are now intertwined. And I want you to see that the house of Ahab in 8:27 is waiting for judgment. The whole time you're reading about this guy, I want you to read Ahaziah's story like this. Dun, 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 dun. He's going to make it 1 year. That's it. It's over. And you need to understand that by 8:28, he's entangled up to his neck at home, and he finds himself on the wrong side of the battle with the Arameans, not because Judah has anything to gain, but because his uncle wanted his army, so Daddy JJ signed him up for an entangled family, and now he's fighting a battle that isn't even his. If he wins, he gets nothing. If he loses, he gets dead. That's a bad bargain. Because he's now tied up fighting for the north instead of bringing Moab and Libna and Edom and bringing them back under control. He's got his own people rebelling, and instead of dealing with them, he's off dealing with somebody else's problem. Why? Because his daddy entangled the two families. So it's wrong priorities, but in verse 29, it's also that he's at the wrong place at the wrong time. Chapter 8 closes with Uncle Joram, king of Israel, pulled off the side of the battle and wounded, with his nephew Ahaziah sitting to comfort his wounded family. Ahaziah never saw the coming terrible events of chapter 9. When you get into chapter 9, it's going to get bad. He never saw it coming. He was set up by the accommodations of his father as well as his own poor choices. Now, the point that I'm trying to make here is that these two things got intertangled in such a way that he ended up with all the wrong priorities, fighting the wrong battle at the wrong time for the wrong reason, while there were responsibilities back home he wasn't taking care of. Now, maybe now it's a good time to ask an important question. Does it really matter if I accommodate sin in my life? Does it really matter? If you're like most people, you're probably thinking that as long as you do reasonably well in life, your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds. That's what most people think. Now, I'll be all right. I didn't murder anybody. I mean, after all, I might have felt like it a few times, but I didn't do it. And I didn't steal, at least nothing too serious. I might have, you know, copied a few files from somebody's music collection that I didn't exactly buy. And, you know, I didn't lie, unless, of course, it's that, you know, white lie, you know, just to make somebody feel better. I mean, you don't want to be mean to people. And I didn't commit adultery, at least not literally and physically. I might have had that wayward thought and maybe got carried away on the internet, or might have had a sexual encounter here or there. But I really didn't hurt anybody. And slowly what happens is we allow sin to come into our lives, and we stretch the truth. We develop a hate towards someone. We take on something that really doesn't belong to us. We tolerate lust and sexual things. We start getting to the place where one day we wake up and it really does matter that I accommodated those things in my life. Because the truth is, it matters more than we calculate. It costs our children something. It costs your town something. It costs your nation something. Sin has an incalculable cost, and we act as though it doesn't hurt anyone. That is the enemy's lie. Go ahead, do it. It won't hurt anybody. The problem is, you break fellowship with God, and that automatically hurts everyone around you. Pat Morley wrote this. He said, a young woman told me, when my father deserted us, I didn't just lose my dad. I lost my mom, too, because she had to work two jobs, and I hardly ever saw her. And Pat made the note, the effect on this young woman has been lifelong. And the whole point is, people walk out the door and they go, look, I'm sorry, I just can't do this. And what they're doing is actually taking it out on the weakest parties around them, because the weak ones can't do anything about it. I want you to go to chapter 9 very quickly and see if you can pick up the bad fruit. The bad fruit happens as a result of this. Now, it says, Elisha the prophet called one of the sons of the prophets and said to him, gird up your loins and take this flask of oil in your hand and go to Ramoth Gilead. And when you arrive there, search out Jehu the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, and go in and bid him arise from among his brothers and bring him into an inner room. Then take the flask of oil and pour it on his head and say, thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel. Then open the door and flee and do not wait. So the young man, the servant of the prophet, went to Ramoth Gilead. When he came, behold, the captain of the army was sitting there. I have a word for you, O captain. And Jehu said, for which one of us? And he said, for you, O captain. He arose, went into the house, poured oil on his head, said to him, thus says the Lord God of Israel, I have anointed you a king over all the people of the Lord, even over Israel. You shall strike the house of Ahab your master. Now you remember this story, right? What does Jehu do? From the kings of the north story, he becomes the next king in the line by doing what? He goes out and he kills the children and the grandchildren and wipes out. And who ends up dying in this story as a result of it? So Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, son of Nimshi, conspired against Joram. Now Joram was with all Israel, was defending Ramot Gilead against Hazael, the king of Aram. But King Joram had returned to Jezreel to be healed of the wounds which the Arameans had inflicted on him when he fought with Hazael, king of Aram. So Jehu said, if this is your mind, then let no one escape or leave the city to go tell it in Jezreel. Then Jehu rode his chariot and went to Jezreel, for Joram was lying there. Ahaziah, king of Judah, had come down to see Joram. There it is. Now the watchman was standing on the tower, and you know what happens. Jehu comes in, and what does he do? He shoots him, and he kills him. Now, go all the way down to verse 21. Then Joram said, get ready, and they made his chariot ready. Joram, king of Israel, and Ahaziah, king of Judah, went out, each to his chariot, and they went out to meet Jehu and found him on the property of Naboth the Jezreelite. When Joram saw Jehu, he said, is it peace, Jehu? And he answered, what peace? So long as the harlotries of your mother Jezebel and her witchcrafts are so many. So Joram reigned about and fled and said to Ahaziah, this is treachery, O Ahaziah. And Jehu drew his bow and with a full strength and shot Joram between his arms. And the arrow went through his heart and he sank in his chariot. Then Jehu said to Bidkar, his officer, take him up and cast him into the property of the field of Naboth the Jezreelite. For I remember when you and I were riding together with Ahab, his father, that the Lord had laid against him the oracle, saying, I have seen yesterday the blood of Naboth and the blood of his sons, and I will repay you in this property, says the Lord. Now, keep going. Get down to verse 27. When Ahaziah, the king of Judah, saw this, he fled by the way of the garden house. Jehu pursued him and said, shoot him, too, in the chariot. So they shot him at the ascent of Gur, which is at Iblim. But he fled to Megiddo, and he died there. The man's life is cut off. And it's largely cut off simply because he's with the wrong people, having made the wrong decision. All of this goes back to one marriage, but it's not over yet. There's a worse moment coming. If you think the family's bad, can you just tell me who do you think Ahab and Jezebel raised in their little princess Athaliah? The kings were bad. The one queen, worse than all of them. This girl made a bad king look good. And she comes in. Now, she is the mother of Ahaziah, and she's the wife of Jehoram, the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel of Israel, and you should already know what kind of reign she has. She's going to be on the throne for 6 years. It is going to be a terrible time to be a believer living in Judah. And by the way, that's the better of the two places to live. So your choices now are bad or worse. And when you follow this down, I'm going to ask you to jump all the way to chapter 11, because in chapter 11, verse 1 begins her story.
When Elathiah, mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she rose and destroyed them all the royal offspring. But Jehosheba, the daughter of King Joram, sister of Ahaziah, took Joash, the son of Ahaziah, and stole him from among the king's sons who were being put to death, and placed him in his nurse in the bedroom.
Okay, now there are some principles of restoring God's redemptive work in the public world that I want you to see here. I don't want this to be so heavy and so negative that you don't see anything of God's hand working here. There's something really good that's happening behind the scenes here. She is terrible. There's no nice way to tell it. She's an awful ruler. There's absolutely nothing I can do with her. But I can tell you that behind the scenes, God is very much at work. Let me just notice a few things about this passage that might be helpful to you. Let me frame it around this, chapter 11. God's working a plan, and he has a great enemy that's trying to thwart the plan. Self-interested, unbelieving people are the enemy's minions. They're all over the place. But God marked a path for restoration, and he does it right under the nose of the enemy, and I want you to see how it works. First, look at verse 1. Athaliah is the mother of Ahaziah. She saw that her son was dead. She rose and destroyed all the royal offspring. What? She saw that her son was dead, so she killed everybody else. What kind of person is this? Let's get out all the baby pictures. Now let's kill them all. Athaliah was so against the plan of God and so open to follow the enemy that her commitment to her parents' wicked ways remind us of people that set a course against their own children's lives. Her parents and where she's coming from were more important than whether or not she had grandchildren. And so she eliminates everybody else of the royal offspring. But when this is happening, look what God does. The enemy counters with, all right, if they're all going to be condemned, fine, I'm going to burn the whole place. And out of this, God has a promise to the household of David. Somebody from the Davidic line needs to live. Just remember this. Satan has only ever had one set of plans: destroy the king or the kingdom. If you can't get the king, get the kingdom. If I can stop God's promises, I can dethrone him. So what he does is tries to figure out a way to... It's not that Satan doesn't know God's word. It's that he doesn't believe God's telling the truth. He thinks he can outplay him. So he's going to bump off all of the line of David so that no one can sit on that throne because God promised somebody would. At the same time, take heart, God is moving in more people than we see. As the darkness fell, God placed in key places people that would never have been suspected and never have stood out. They were the backbone people that quietly were the people of God. Look at verse 2. This is the daughter of King Joram, sister of Ahaziah, and she took Joash, the son of Ahaziah, and stole him from the king's sons from being put to death, takes him out of the bedroom, out of the nursery, and hides him. Where does he go? It says he was hidden, verse 3, in the house of the Lord 6 years while Athaliah was reigning over the land. So he's a youngster. By the way, he's not a baby. He's a child. But he gets to be old enough during the 6 years that he actually can be a regent for the throne. She doesn't know that there's an opposing person still alive. She thinks she's killed off all of the rivals and she alone will be queen. So for 6 years, Athaliah is queen, believing she's killed off every possible rival, even though they were related to her. And ultimately, it says, in the 7th year, Jehoiada sent and brought captain of hundreds and Kerites and the guard and brought them to the house of the Lord. Then he made a covenant with them and put them under an oath in the house of the Lord and showed them the king's son. So what he does is... He brings out the crown prince, the next king. He's a child. And when he exposes the people that would guard that king, they were totally dumbfounded that he was alive because they all thought everybody was dead too. But the organization of the operation was in the hands of the high priest. That's who Jehoiada is. So make a note in your Bible because you might lose track of him. He's a high priest. It's interesting because in 2 Chronicles 24, there's an interesting note about him. Now, Jehoiada was old and full of years, and he died at the age of 130. He was buried with the kings in the city of David because he was good and had done in Israel for God and his temple. That's 2 Chronicles 24, verses 15 and 16. 2 Chronicles 24, 15 and 16. So this guy, Jehoiada, he lives to be 130 years old and gets buried with kings. No high priest gets buried with kings. Bless you. What you have is this incredible, quiet thing going on. Who are the Kerites, by the way? Caria is in Western Asia Minor. It's in Turkey today. They're mercenaries that served as the Secret Service bodyguards. So they are quite literally the bodyguards for the king, and they come in. They're brought in from the outside, so they don't have any tie to any of the families. They just guard. They're mercenaries. They get paid. Jehoiada brings them in and says, here's the next king. And he comes from the bloodline. I am the high priest. This is the temple. I ain't lying. This guy is the next king. Now, what's interesting is when he does that, he then sets up Athaliah. Go down to verse 5. He commanded them, saying, this is the thing you shall do. One-third of you who come in on the Sabbath and keep watch over the king's house, one-third shall also be at the gate sore, and one-third shall be at the gate behind the guards. You shall keep watch over the house for defense. Two parts of you, even who go out on the Sabbath, shall also keep watch over the house of the Lord for the king. Then you shall surround the king, each with his weapons in his hands, and whoever comes within the ranks shall be put to death. And be with the king when he goes out and when he comes in. I need you guys to form a secret service guard team. I want you to surround this boy. People aren't going to know who he is yet. He's not been declared as the next king yet, but I need you to become his detailed surrounding servants. I don't want him to go anywhere but around the temple of the living God, but when he's here, you are always there and you are armed. I know. It's weird to have armed people in the temple. Do it. That's what I want done. So the captains and the hundreds did according to what all the Jehoiada the priest commanded. Each one of them took his men and were come in, and on the Sabbath with those who were going to go out on the Sabbath, and came to Jehoiada the priest. The priest gave to the captains of the hundreds the spears and the shields, which had been King David's, which were in the house of the Lord. The guards stood, each with his weapons in his hand, from the right side of the house to the left side of the house, by the altar and by the house around the king. Then he brought the king's son out, put the crown on him, and gave him the testimony. What's the testimony? This is the word edut. Ed means to witness. Edut, what is the testimony? What was, according to Moses, supposed to happen when you got a king? He was supposed to review the law and then write it in his own hand. Jehoiada, being high priest, is the one who knows how a king's accession is supposed to be. So here's what I want you to see. This time, young Jehoash is growing up at the hands of a high priest who's doing it all correctly, okay? He's the last standing member of the house of David that could take the throne, and Jehoiada is not going to take any chance. So here's what God does. God maneuvers to take the last guy who could possibly stand up and do what he wants done, and he puts over him a high priest who trains him secretly in the law. So now all of a sudden, while Athaliah is on the throne, this next king is already being schooled to be king the way a king should have been all along. So he walks in and he actually gets incredible benefits. He actually knows a great deal, even though he's one of the youngest kings of Israel. And you know what's going to be interesting? 6 years Athaliah will torment Israel. 40 years the king that is raised by the high priest will serve. 40 years. He will be one of the longest running, not the longest, but one of the longest running kings in the household of Judah. Why? Because God tried to write it and put back and restore a heart back to the throne. What's interesting is eventually what happens is she comes down and she is to be in the presence of this new king. It says it in verse 12. That they brought out the king's son out and put the crown on him and gave him the testimony, and they made him king and anointed him. And they clapped their hands and said, long live the king! When Queen Athaliah heard the noise of the guard and of the people, she came to the people in the house of the Lord. She looked, and behold, the king was standing by the pillar, according to the custom, with the captains and the trumpeters beside the king. And all the people of the land rejoiced and blew trumpets, put in parentheses, because they were sick to death of this wicked woman who had been usurping their throne. How popular do you think she was after she had killed all the babies in the family? Athaliah tore her clothes and cried, treason, treason, as if she didn't commit treason when she got there. She's so shocked. And it's amazing because it says Jehoiada the priest commanded the captains of hundreds who were appointed over the army and said to them, bring her out between the ranks and whoever follows her put to death with the sword. For the priest said, let her not be put to death in the house of the Lord. So they took her out. They seized her. And when she arrived at the horse's entrance, the king's house, then she was put to death there. And Jehoiada made a covenant between the Lord and the king and the people that they would be the Lord's people. Also between the king and the people, all the people of the land went to the house of Baal, tore it down. His altars were and images they broke in pieces thoroughly and killed Matan, the priest of Baal, before the altars. And the priest appointed officers over the house of the Lord. He took captains of hundreds and the Kerites and the guards and all the people of the land, and they brought the king down from the house of the Lord and came by the way of the gate to the guards to the king's house, and he sat on the throne of the king. So all the people of the land rejoiced, and the city was quiet. For they had put Athaliah to death with a sword at the king's house. Jehoash, look, was 7 years old when he became king. So he was barely walking when they hit him, and now he comes and he's been 6 years in hiding, about a year old when he's put in hiding, and now we have a seven-year-old king, but he's a regent king. What does that mean? Somebody else is charged with giving him advice. Who would that be? Jehoiada. And now we have a high priest who loves God, who's running the kingdom with a young boy who's learning to love God, who's a runner-up for king.